I used to be somebody else, but I traded him in.
What the hell happened to them? Jack attacks the cast. That's right. Jack Nicholson this season. I am your host, Patrick Skeyhill, and joining me on the line is a man who might not be who he is, Joe Vekeman.
Who am I? Oh, I get it. I get what you did. That's good.
Glad you watched the movie this week, Joe. That's great.
I watched it twice, to be fair. I watched it twice in a row.
Might as well. I don't blame you. Why'd you watch it twice in a row?
Well, because I was getting very sleepy the first time I watched it, and I'm like, now I really want to hear the Jack Nicholson commentary.
Okay.
So I just was like, let's dive right back in. Because let's be fair, kind of a sleepy movie.
And on the audio boards is Levin Rensselaer, reminding me to remind you that you can email the cast at whathappenedtothemcast@gmail.com. And our sponsor this week is Avis, the most efficient way to drive away from all of your obligations. Joe, what movie are we doing this week?
We watched 1975's The Passenger.
Yes, finally. 27 films ago, Patrick Skeyhill thought, all right, I'll sit through all this so we can do The Passenger. One of my top films. Probably a strong reason for why I push for the Jack Nicholson season. And we are here. We can just take the rest of the season off. Doesn't matter after this. Might be the best movie we ever do for this podcast. I don't foresee any future actor giving us something on Antonioni's level.
Well, what I was proposing was we do a John Cazale film series.
All right. I'm sure everybody would love that.
Six of the greatest movies, right?
They'd be like, who's this guy? We know him from all these movies we like. Yeah, but you don't know who he
Godfather,
is.
Godfather, Dog Day Afternoon, Deer Hunter.
Sounds like we should just do like an Al Pacino.
I mean, yeah, that's what you would do.
Bring us back to Jack and Jill.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Yeah.
I love Jack and Jill.
Somebody else defended Jack and Jill to me too recently. And I go, what's going on? Is something in the water? What is happening?
Something's in the water. And let me tell you, it tastes like a Dunkachino.
All right, Joe. Well,
do you want a plot synopsis?
So summarize The Passenger.
I'll give you the plot synopsis, but then I'm going to tell you what was going on with me when I watched this movie the first time with you. So, unable to find the war he's been asked to cover, a frustrated war correspondent takes the risky path of co-opting the identity of a dead arms deal acquaintance.
And so what was going on in your head was, what is this what it would be like if the Fast and Furious made an art house film?
No.
Okay.
At first, when I watched this movie with you, well, I guess for the first like three times I watched it, because I didn't know what he was or what he was doing before I heard the Jack Nicholson commentary. The Jack Nicholson commentary opened up this movie.
Why, you didn't know?
I did not know
he
was a war
reporter. You said
you liked
the movie when we saw it at the Jack Nicholson retrospective at the Somerville Theater.
I also liked it when we watched it on your TV in your room.
Oh, that's right. We did do that. So you've seen it like four times then.
This is my fourth time. Because of the commentary.
Do you remember when when they did the Jack Nicholson retrospective, they tried to get it on, 35 millimeter as often as they could for their projection room. And this one, they said, was the cleanest print they'd ever seen. And my thought was, well, yeah, nobody's showing this movie anywhere.
Which is crazy.
Of course it's so clean. It's been screened like four times. Sucks, but really good movie. Really clean print.
The fourth time it was screened in America.
Yeah, especially since like the Psych Out print was all warped and mangled and shitty. It was kind of crazy. All right, Joe, go on.
That one was
That watching. One, King of Marvin Gardens, was really crapped up. And Five Easy Pieces, like those ones were all garbled. It was kind of crazy.
Five Easy Pieces is still my favorite movie we've watched so far.
All right, so tell me what you thought was going on in the movie, and now that your eyes have been opened.
Yeah, well, what I thought was going on was that he was just a guy hanging out in the desert, and he was like, my car's stuck. And I'm like, that sucks. I don't know why he was out there.
So all the stuff about him being a news person, that made no sense to you?
It never clicked. And I never knew he was a news person. I was paying attention, but when I watch a movie, I really just kind of like vibe with it first.
Yeah.
And then this is a sleepy vibes movie. So I realized that I think I've fallen asleep every time we've watched this movie for at least like 10 or 15 minutes because there was like, there's a new scenes. They've added new scenes.
I lose all credibility now talking about how great this movie is if my co-host falls asleep every time he watches the movie.
No, that is a compliment. This movie is a beautiful lullaby. I love this. I love watching this movie. I have a great time with it. I just like the hangout vibes.
So you heard it here, folks. Joe loves this movie so much, it's worth sleeping to. Is that what I'm...
I'm saying, well, because I've watched the whole movie in full now, definitely, with the commentary especially.
Okay.
But I just get sleep... When we watched it the first time, it was definitely me, like, coming over to your house before work where I was like exhausted from waking up early or something. The second time we watched it, it was like late in the day and I probably worked the night before. And then I watched it on Tuesday morning and I was coming home from work and I was like, okay, here we go. I'm very sleepy, but let's put it on. And I was like, sleep. And then I was like, I gotta watch the whole thing. Really gotta make sure I watch the whole thing. So I was like, commentary. So I sat up and I was listening to it. It was great.
It just feels a damning sign that you...
It's not, no.
Sleep through The Passenger, but don't sleep through Black Adam.
Black Adam is a noisy fucking nuisance. It's impossible to fall asleep to that movie because it's just so... It's like someone beating you in the head with a hammer and saying, stay up!
Yeah.
But like with those like plastic hammers, you know, like the kids have like the little...
Like a little air squishy sound.
Yeah.
That's not the sound, but you get the gist.
No, I really like this movie. I really do. I love it a lot. I love the vibes. I love when he's screaming in the desert and the Antonioni says, told Jack, he's like, really overact in this scene. And Jack's like, okay, I guess. And he talks in the commentary. He's just like, I always wanted to be in an Antonioni movie. This guy is a master. And I'm just like, he's just a fan.
Yeah, no.
He's just fanning out the whole time.
I was screened this movie... I had two classes back to back with this Russian composer lady in my undergrad, Julia Goryuchnika. She gave me her album. I forget what it's called, but I have it over on my CD shelf. Anyway, one class was a composition class. Then there was another, some type of film critical scholarly class thing. And in that one, she showed us The Passenger. And of course... I'm the only one in the class who likes it. But the whole time I'm like, why is, you know, thinking of Jack Nicholson as anger management bucket list Jack Nicholson. I'm like, why the fuck is he doing this movie? Why would he give a obviously now that we've done 27 films, I go, oh, because he's a big movie nerd. Because he's a huge ass nerd. And Antonioni is like the, I don't know, Captain Picard of the cinema universe at the time, Patrick Stewart. So, of course, you're going to want to work with this when the opportunity comes up. I don't blame him.
So, I think I have an answer for one of the reasons why Criterion hasn't been able to grab this movie yet.
Yeah, you said you have a Blu-ray of this? Who made yours?
I have a regular Blu-ray, like a plain-ass Blu-ray that has the it has a couple of commentaries on it, one with Jack. So... Wanting to protect a piece of art that he loved, Jack Nicholson bought the rights to this film shortly after its release and kept it out of circulation for many years. In 2003, he entered into negotiations with Sony to re-release the film. So Sony has the, like, I guess is the distributor right now, but he owns it. So they have to go to him to get the movie.
Jack wanted to protect the film, so he said,
it.
No one will ever watch this again. Ha, it's mine. Jack, come on. Come on, buddy. Jack, who are you going to trust more than the Criterion? They'd even sit with you while they restore it.
He records that commentary is from 2003. He's an old man recording that and recollecting on that movie. He's basically narrating the film for me, and I'm like, this is so helpful. I know what's going on now.
He's there trying to remember, like, okay, yeah, here, this is actually a flashback. Yes, this is a flashback. Okay, good.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, no, that totally helped. I was so confused. Everything was brought to light. Hold on.
This hurts, Joe.
With Antonioni, this is the only Antonioni I've ever watched.
Which is a shame, but go on.
I will get into it. I've just been filling in gaps with other filmographies first. He seems to have... like set these like the time like of the movie, like with just certain little details like hanging on the wall. That's how you like, or like a notepad or like something like that. You don't really like no one. It doesn't say on the bottom of the screen, hey, this is this date on this date.
Yeah, I know. But like the cinema, I'll get.
I like that.
To the nitty gritty of a cinematic grammar later and what he does to change film forever. But the moment I really love this movie was in that Russian ladies class. And he's working on the passports. And by the way, what a time to be alive when passports were so easily forged. It took like no effort. It was crazy. So he's there, he's listening to the recording, and we just kind of pan over, and suddenly the recording has come to life. It was this eye-opening experience for me when I go, oh my God, this is what film can do. This is what we're capable of. It's what, if I can speak in snooty film critic speak for a moment, famous film scholar Deleuze called the time image. And he said at a certain point, film evolved to taking more advantage of its place in time more than in space, what had been called the time movement, when it had moved away from being a play. And we'll get into more on how that happened in a moment, too. But like for time, and this is why I love Tarkovsky, for time, it's always a continual present. It's always constantly the now. And so you can bring this past into the present so seamlessly and not have it feel weird. I don't know. It just was like, I know this guy's dead. I'm hearing this dead guy talk. We're now seeing them over there. Obviously, this is a flashback, and we just got to it in a more fluid way that doesn't feel like it's jarring from Jack's present. Because when you start on present Jack Nicholson, move to this recording flashback-ish thing, we know that that's Jack reliving it right there in the present. So we're in his interior in that moment as he's going through that memory in a more visual way that allows for the medium to take full advantage of its tools. Is that making sense?
Of course. Yeah, no, because Jack explained it all to me.
Oh, yeah.
It was like literally like a film like class lesson with Jack. I was like, this is great. Like I didn't pick up. I'm sorry. I felt like a fucking idiot watching him.
Yeah.
Like the first couple times with you. Because I'm like, I get that he's like taking this guy's identity. I get that. Like, obviously that's pretty fucking clear. But like, I didn't know that we were going back and forth in time and stuff. Like I just didn't click with me. Now I get it. And now I'm like, this movie's even more fucking brilliant than I thought. I was just vibing with it. Like I told you, I was like, this, I just like this like slow pace. It's I love seeing Jack in like a foreign setting, basically. Cause this obviously doesn't like taste come. Is it Europe? He's in Europe, right?
After he leaves Africa, he's pretty much in Europe the rest of the way.
Yeah.
It's mostly Germany and Spain.
Yeah.
And then he spends, I guess there's a little time we get in England with his old co-workers and wife.
I mean, I was digging the whole thing. I don't know. I only have a few things I need to add to it. This is yours. But I will tell you that when Michael, Michelangelo.
I should say Michelangelo Antonioni.
That's what Jack kept saying. He kept calling him Michelangelo.
Yeah, and that's like, how they would say it over there.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So that's why
we say Michelangelo because of the Ninja Turtles.
Is that really just it?
Probably. I don't know. That's my that was my only exposure to Michelangelo.
So when Michelangelo Antonioni received his honorary Oscar in 1995,
Antonioni. The emphasis is on the ant, but like that's if you go Michelangelo, you might as well go the full way.
Okay.
But I'll say Antonioni because I'm dumb American guy.
I am the face of dumb American guy. The Academy asked Jack Nicholson to present it to him, which is very nice. But I also saw something further down here that Antonioni. See, now you're going to fuck me.
Antonioni.
Antonioni. His first pick for the reporter that Jack Nicholson was playing was Donald Sutherland.
Yeah, I wouldn't hate that either. That'd be fine.
It's just a very different movie.
I don't think so.
You don't think so? I think they bring
like other than a couple of small flourishes, Jack's sort of basically doing whatever Antonioni wants him to do. I think Donald Sutherland could do that too. So how did he end up with Jack instead of Donald? Did Donald like say, "Nah, I don't want to do this weird thing"?
Was he doing Don't Look Now then?
No, wasn't that earlier in the '70s? Another fancy art house genre piece.
I know. It was 73. It was a little earlier.
Well, I don't know. I don't know when this movie started filming, though. Antonioni liked to take his sweet-ass time making films. He'd be notable for always underestimating the amount of time it would take to shoot. He'd be like, ah, may we borrow this yacht for 10 days? And it would take 20 days. And he'd be like, ah, may we film at this house for 2 weeks? And it would be like 3 months. And, ah, we only need to shoot this scene for 3 hours. And, of course, it'd be 2 days. So, you know, he might have started making this film in 1972. I don't know.
So, I guess MGM distributed the movie originally?
So, Michelangelo, he has a career in film for like 10 years in the 50s and the late 40s, documentaries and these kind of like chamber drama comedy things. And they're all failures. Totally unassuming filmmaker of no note. And one day he says, fuck it, I'm going to make La Ventura and reinvent cinematic grammar. And it is a worldwide success. And in the 60 through 64, he makes 4 films, all world-class, seismic-shifting films. And MGM says, holy shit, you're a big deal. What, could we hire you to make 3 English-language films for us? And he says, ah, okay. Blow Up is one of them, Zabriskie Points 1 and Passengers 1. 2 of probably of his best films, and then 1 okay film.
Which one, Zabriskie Point?
Yeah, Zabriskie Point's fine. Notably, all 3 of those movies, interestingly enough, have drugs and guns and murder. And I go, ah, the American. And they're all male focus, which his other 4 films weren't really. So I'm like, ah, of course. You know, like they pass the Bechdel test and these 3 don't. Like, ah, well, you get to the English speaking countries and we're like, no. Men and guns, please. And yet still, they're very good, despite these old tropes and cliches of the Western world. Like, awesome. Let's do it.
Some other big things in the commentary. I'll start with, so Maria Schneider, who is the, I guess, the female lead in this. She doesn't come until late into the movie.
She's
though. Very
late, and even like hinted at too. She comes in technically at what would be the end of the first act, and then like she's gone again for another 40 minutes.
Yeah. So Jack is recalling this time on set where she was having back issues, so she was taking a lot of pain pills. And so she was so out of it filming some of these scenes that in one scene he's like, I was basically holding her up by the nape of her neck because she was just so out of it reciting these lines. And I'm like, Jesus.
I feel bad for her back. What'd she do to it?
I don't know. He didn't go into it.
Nah.
Well, no, he didn't go into it. He just said she was on like pain pills for her back. She hurt her back or something. The other thing he talks about is, I don't know if you've ever told me, you know, how they did this shot, but the final shot.
Oh, yeah, I did tell you. But that's all right. Tell the audience.
Antonioni constructed the entire hotel so that the final shot could be accomplished, though he suggests the entire hotel was built on hinges instead of simply the bars outside the window. This assertion is incorrect, as production photos and several books testify that the shot was made by opening the bars, which were on hinges, and allowing the camera to pass through and be picked up outside. What also attracted Antonioni to the building is that it used to be a church. It was across the street from a bullfighting ring. And he said he also just didn't want to shoot a death scene. That's why he made this big elaborate shot.
I mean, I think it's the way to do it, especially since
it's incredible. It's so like, it's such a
wonderful. Yeah, another thing that had me hooked. And I'm just looking around this class of other, I guess we were 21-year-olds at the time. And I go, how are you not interested in this? You fools. You fools. Like, Marvel Eve wasn't even, like, a couple, two or three Marvel films have come out, but it wasn't huge yet. I guess more had come out. Avengers was about to come out that
year. How can you compare these to a Marvel?
I just thought, like, that wasn't even, like, big in the culture yet, you know? Like, Marvel came in and changed what we expect from cinema, and so that hadn't happened yet. So I'm like, why aren't you guys, like, enraptured by it? Get off your phones. I didn't have a smartphone at the time either. Maybe that helped me versus them, but
Marvel feels like it's just on an island of different films right now. Like, they don't feel real.
It's forced all other cinema to change in its wake. You've either had to go really, really far against it, which is what Passenger films were doing all this time anyway, or you had to become like it. And that's what all these other films are doing now. So,
well, this is the first year since, I believe, like 2010 or 2011, that a Marvel or a Star Wars film isn't at the top of the box office.
Well, you know, it's going to be hard to beat Avatar. That snuck in there at the last minute.
Yeah, Avatar, in theaters for less than 17 days, it's already made $1 billion. Big Jim did it again.
It has currently got to $1.5 billion. It still needs $500 million to be considered profitable. It will need to make more money afterwards, too. But it's got a bit of a ways to go still, but I do think it will clear it. It just wasn't as quickly as I expected, which gives me a little hope. for the world.
Yeah. I mean, it's good. It's a good movie.
Yeah, I'm sure. Anyway.
It is. It's fun. It's a fun time.
You don't need to show the death scene because you already showed us he was dead, and you did it when he's looking at the guy, at the dead Robertson. Like, they're face to face. They look almost identical. He's looking at himself being dead and kind of acknowledging that. And this is metonymical filmmaking, which is what he pioneered. Now we go to film school, everybody. Welcome to Patrick Scales' film class. I get accused a lot of being artsy-fartsy film guy. And while it's technically true, I also hate artsy-fartsy films. Artsy-fartsy films are ones that are like, I like Fellini enough, but like a lot of problems I have with Fellini is like, aha, this clown represents his sadness. And I go, this is a very literary way of looking at it. And when you watch film, the way your brain engages with film is instantly. When you read a book, you have to kind of translate the word in your head and then get to that association with it, but also be constructing its relationship to the rest of the info at the same time. It's a lot of past-oriented thinking. In the film, you see a tree, immediately you go, there's no translating, it's a direct, it's why I like film, it just goes right there. So when I have to put in extra work to be like, what is this clown sadness? But that's not the best way to utilize the medium, narratively. So what Antonioni pioneers is this metonymical filmmaking. It is not a metaphor, it is not a symbol, we are literally looking at him staring at his dead self. He likes to talk about old versus new a lot in Italy at the time because they were going through a post-war transition, and so when he wants somebody to be standing in for the old guard of Italy, they put him near an old building. You know, the younger character gets put near a new building. He wants all of the color design in this, despite being in color, is very monochrome. Jack, when he's in the desert, isn't all like tan-looking beige clothing. He's blending in with the desert. He's lost in the landscape. He doesn't have a strong sense of self. Same with Maria a lot of the time. When he's sort of standing out of the thing over the air, he's soaring over the air. We don't see him.
Yeah.
We don't see him in the pod thing that's carrying him over the water. We're looking just straight down, and we only see him flying over the water. He literally is soaring at his high point. He's his most free. There's no symbol to it. It's what we're actually seeing. That's sort of the strong advantage here.
Did you know that PTA kind of stole that shot for the master?
Yeah, I don't blame him. Why wouldn't you steal from this
guy? It
looks
really good.
What a metonym is a, it's a different literary device. It's a part for a whole. You want somebody to stand in for the old world Italy, you have them stand near an old building. It's a part for a whole. It's not symbols. It's not metaphor. It allows us to read behaviors and movements within a composition instead of having to kind of put these more intellectually rigid meanings into something. And usually those also can't change over time. They have to be this one symbol the whole time. It allows for things to be a lot more visually dense in the film, which is what a film is. It's a visual medium. It allows to create a more psychological and intuitive resonance with the viewer. It allows us to go into the interior of the character and of the world of the film. And that's what Antonioni wanted to do. Whereas what we remember happening earlier in the 50s Italy, in the late 40s, we got neorealism, and that was an external cinema. Like The Bicycle Thief is the classic example by Vittorio De Sica. The internal action was less important. It was about a man whose bike was stolen, and what does he do about it now? There are some psychological things going on in there, but it's really about the plot of man's bike stolen. Antonioni wanted to move beyond that. He said, that's done. We've done what we can with external factors. I'm interested in the psychological motivations and ramifications of the behaviors of the character. And so in these films, and why Joe may fall asleep, is it seems like nothing is happening, but it lets us imprint ourselves onto the character, onto their behaviors versus their actions, because we're with them as they be, as they exist. That is kind of what opened my mind when I got to see this, and a lot of my film has kind of moved more in this direction. And, you know, Joe says about the vibes, that's true. Like, a lot of the best compliments I get about my films are they're like, I didn't understand everything that was going on, but I really vibed with it. And that's okay, because they got enough to enjoy the film the first time, and they'll get more out of it with each viewing. Further viewings are thus encouraged, and I think that should be a goal in filmmaking, too. I've watched a lot of good films 100%. I don't ever need to see again. And you probably get diminishing returns from having seen them.
Vibes are a big deal for me. If I'm vibing with a movie, I'm like, I'm probably going to want to rewatch this. Which, okay, four times, and I finally got to what I like so much about the movie.
Yeah, what is
it? I figured it out. The vibes!
The vibes. Vibes are a perfectly good thing to like about... I've got no problem if you're liking the vibes of a film. A perfectly fine reason.
I like the slowness of it.
Yeah.
I just like how it feels a little surreal sometimes because it's like a very dreamlike quality because you just kind of go, you're going in and out of scenes and you're just like...
Yeah, Jack's psychological state too is fugue-like. You know, the whole beginning, nobody's talking. For like 15 minutes, nobody's talking. It's awesome. I love it when a film shuts up. This is a film about a guy who's dissatisfied with his life, which is a common theme in Antonioni's world. These middle class, you know, ennui people, like all these like technological advancements have brought a lot of prosperity, quote unquote, to people. And yet we're still miserable because there's something that we're ignoring in our bodies and our souls, an emotional disconnect we have. You can find out a lot about this in my video essay that I did, I Am Michelangelo, on my Vimeo and YouTube page at Quixotic United, finishing off season one of my film essays. But anyway, so a normal film, a normal boring Hollywood film, like, you know, Walter Mitty, right? Is that the one? That the Ben Stiller one? Secret Life of Walter Mitty.
Why are you taking a shit on Secret Life of Walter Mitty?
Right, a guy who's born his life, and we go see his...
Fine movie. We see a 6 out of 10.
See his day-to-day life, and he looks bored and demurred, and everything feels like, well, that's how you would normally see that. But Antonioni externalizes Jack Nicholson with the environment. He's in a desert. It's barren. It's listless. There's no life. Nobody is willing to help him. He's unable to help anybody else. There are too many dead ends. There's no salvation on the horizon. This is all, and he's, like I said, his clothes are matching the environment. He's kind of stuck there. He can't dig himself out of it. He's ready to give up. This is not too thinky. We feel, watching the desert and this the long editing and these many roads to nowhere, the hopelessness of the whole situation. We're not there. It's not the desert's not a metaphor. It literally is the thing we're seeing. Barren, lifeless, inescapable.
He screamed out something. He's like, I don't want any of this anymore.
He's like, I don't care anymore. You win. You win.
I just want to point out really quick, because you were talking about how it was so silent. The beginning of the movie is so silent, and it's wonderful. And Jack in the commentary is just like talking about like everything that's happening in the beginning. He's like, he goes into this hut, and he sees a guy on the ground, and the guy puts two fingers to his mouth, indicating he wants a cigarette. That's how he's narrating the movie. He's like indicating he wants a cigarette. He gives him a cigarette, and he's like, maybe he'll take him somewhere where he needs to go. Maybe not. Who knows? Like... Great.
It's a lot of behavior stuff here, and like it forces us to be a more active participant.
Mm-hmm.
Now we have to pay attention to all the clues for the film to let us know how we're supposed to engage with it. And that's okay that your film has to do that. And it's okay for us to put in a little work here. But like we're just feeling it. We're like, oh my God, when will he get out? When will he find the thing he's looking for? I think it helps that you have Jack Nicholson because we already know we like him. We're like, oh, we've seen a Jack Nicholson film. This will be awesome. But like, Jack, get out of this desert.
Yeah, and he recalls as soon as he gets out of the desert, he walks into that hotel and he's just like, the first thing he's like, what would you ask for? And then he immediately says in the movie, like, water. Yeah. Like, that's a good joke.
Yeah. And then also visually, he switches identities. He goes to tell the staff the guy's dead. Yes. And we're like looking behind Jack Nicholson for the next minute and a half or 2 minutes. And everybody else is reacting and they're like, you're Jack. And he goes, no, 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 I'm the other guy. And they go, oh, yes, of course. Sorry. All white people look alike to us.
Oh, so that guy is like some producer that he knew from another movie.
Oh,
and he's like, they worked on it together. He's like, because Antonio is like, do you know anyone that kind of looks like you? And he's like, I think I know a guy. So that's where that guy came from.
Yeah. So like by being behind him, like the movie visually is changing his identity too. He gets to like go into a cocoon metamorphosis kind of thing. And we have to kind of reorient ourselves to him now that he'll have the glasses on. He'll eventually add the mustache.
The mustache. And he like sticks it on the lamp.
Yeah. Like that's a nice little Jack Nicholson flourish. You kind of like... I almost wonder if, like, he was realizing he the actor, didn't like it as he was on that phone call. And he's like, all right, well, fuck it. And he just, like, playfully puts it on a light and walks away. That feels like Jack Nicholson might have done that on his own. And Antonioni was like, yeah, you know what? That feels believable. We're good. He kind of has that joy de vivre Jack has, that kind of, like, joy of life from doing something a little impish that Jack Nicholson usually gets.
Okay, I got something else for you. I don't know if you knew about this. Antonioni had first made a four-hour cut of the film himself and then brought in editor Franco Arcali to trim it to just under 2.5 hours. This was still too long for MGM, which demanded a cut under 2 hours for the North American market and required that it be titled The Passenger.
What was it called before?
I will try to find that. At 118 minutes, the MGM version is shorter than... It's Italian. I don't know. Profession reporter.
Okay. Yeah, I do remember that now.
By approximately 5 minutes, and excludes two crucial scenes. One dealing with Locke's surreptitious return visit to his London home, where he finds evidence of Rachel's infidelities with her lover Stephen, played by Stephen Burkoff, whose name is misspelled in the closing credits, and whose screen time was clearly greater in the nearly 150-minute version. In one of the last interviews he conducted before his massive stroke in 1983, Antonioni publicly condemned the MGM version. It was so disturbed at the cuts forced on him that he considers the longer version mutilated as well. Wow.
Well, we understand why they didn't re-up their contracts together.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, and it's a rare instance where the studio had a better suggestion for a title than the artist. Passenger, very great title. Professione colon reporter?
Not very good.
I feel like most of the times those would be reversed, where they're like, the passenger doesn't mean anything, Antonioni. He's a reporter. We'll call it professional reporter. And he's like, what? Why?
I think he's crazy. This movie works. It's good. I like it.
Movie does work.
I mean, sometimes, you know, sometimes studio notes are helpful. I don't know if this movie needed to be that long. 4 hours? I know
4 hours is probably too long, especially since we've enjoyed it quite a bit at the length. It doesn't feel like things are missing. I think the information we have to bridge, I think you can bridge it, and I think it makes the film more enjoyable. I think having us having to do that work is better for us as an audience. I'm never confused. The information's all there.
Yeah.
Something obviously was going on with the wife and the flashback we get of that. And we also get Jack Nicholson's kind of melancholic interpretation of that memory as he's looking back on it, too. So, I don't know. It all works for me.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, this movie, it works so much better. You don't need... I mean, I know it's damning to say the studio notes helped the artist figure out where the movie needs to, like, when the movie needs to be. But it's just like, he nailed it.
He cut it down from 4 hours on his own to the two hours and 20 minutes. And between that and the, whatever, hour and 50-something minutes, you know.
The movie's 126 minutes.
How hurtful of a difference of time that is. So he understood himself that there was a lot to do. Those are two versions I'd like to see back to back and know how much of that is helpful. And again, studios aren't always giving bad notes, all right? Studios aren't there to be your enemy, filmmakers, all right? They can. I've gotten helpful notes from people with different minded sensibilities to me because they're considering things in a way I don't. But sometimes people are unwilling to approach the property on its terms or don't actually know what they're talking about and make things up so they sound important. Like that's an issue you get in Hollywood is a lot of people just have bad ideas because they don't know what they're doing, and that sucks. But a lot of people do know what they're doing, and they have good ideas.
Or sometimes they just want to follow trends.
Or like some stupid knee-jerk reaction to something or to something. Yeah, I don't know. So why this metonymical filmmaker is so important is it sort of finishes what Wells started by realizing that film is a visual medium. You know, Wells kind of gave film an identity when he made Citizen Kane and was like, we don't have to be a play, everybody. We can do our own things here because we're a different medium. I guess Griffith sort of started that. He gave cinema a foundation. Wells gives film, cinema, an identity, but Antonioni gives it a heart. He gives it a soul. And that allowed for us to be more emotionally and engaged versus intellectually. We got to kind of exist and vibe with the film along then. And it pretty much filmmakers to this day all somehow can trace their inspirational lineage to Antonioni, directly or indirectly. That's how important he's been to filmmaking. He and Godard kind of came out around the same time, and both Godard changed things a lot on like a practical level, on a production level, on a distribution level, things like that. Antonioni really got to it, though, with the cinematic grammar. Not that Godard did, too, but just film wouldn't be what it is today without Antonioni. Even the films I don't like, they all owe something to this guy. We got an addition to the kill count for Jack Nicholson.
Bulleted.
The kill count?
Oh, yeah, we got a kill count. We started this in... What movie did we start this in? One of these motorcycle movies, we started the kill count.
Did he ever actually kill anybody in The Crybaby Killer? Because that was his first movie, The Crybaby Killer.
Yeah, I know, but one of the motorcycle films, you were like, we should do a kill count for Jack Nicholson. You know, Lev made a bump and everything, so.
Oh, excellent.
We got the kill count.
Well, let me go back a little bit.
You gotta look now what our total kill count is. In the meantime, I'll talk about the theme of existentialism in this film. I'll talk about it briefly, as you people turn down your radio to do dishes or whatever for this portion, but it'll be really quick, don't worry. You just get some great quotes where Maria Schneider's like, people disappear every day. Jack Nicholson's like, every time they leave the room, right? This is sort of very true, especially in a metonymical filmmaking where when somebody does leave, they do cease to exist to us. In La Ventura, you know, a film famous for kind of forgetting about one of its main characters 2/3 of the way through the film, it's sort of the same thing. Well, we don't see them, so they don't exist anymore. And that leads to different quandaries for those characters in that film. In this film, Murray Schneider's like, what are you running away from? And Jack Nicholson's just like, turn around. We get sort of a very similar shot of the background moving behind her to when Jack's kind of flying over the water. But she takes it very differently. The film is now transitioning to Jack's fleeing from obligations, this freedom that he has actually being a damning thing. And we'll get to, you know, the consequences of that play out in the end of the film, and I won't spoil that for you. Then, of course, the last line of the film, I never knew him, Jack Nicholson, whose identity has shifted many times through the film. Similar issue, you know, he wanted to be free, and it just caused him to exist less, so did changing his life make that possible? Was he never going to be able to escape his fate? Is there a fatalism to this with this kind of appointment book motif going on? One could also argue that coincidence plays a role in the plot, perhaps a bigger role than is desirable. I would say on the one hand, again, with Joe's comment about vibes being his favorite thing about the movie, plot isn't obviously the most important thing. It is a character film. But I would also argue that these coincidences are sort of the point. Jack is getting caught up and getting swept away. His wife complains earlier in the film that he just accepted things too easily, and this involved kind of the warlords in Africa kind of feeding him canned rhetoric for his news reports. And Jack Nicholson, he kind of realizes it himself and sort of just lampshade dims it. He talks about he just kind of want to get swept up in the current, and that's sort of the passenger of the movie, is him just kind of going along for the ride and kind of having to succumb to the fate that comes at the end of it, in the hopes of not having to have any autonomy and the obligations that come with it.
He is the titular passenger.
Yeah, he is the passenger. And, it, you know, the movie begins with it at where it ends, at the broken car. You know, his car breaks down in the desert at the beginning. His car has that bad pan at the end as he's running from the law. He was never going to escape what was coming to him. Yeah, Joe.
I think it started in Flight to Fury. Remember the movie where he has a mustache?
Yeah, that's right. He's the bad guy. Yeah, yeah.
I feel like that's when the kill count started.
Yeah, but that's not when you brought up the idea.
I don't know then. I know that was in July of last year.
That's fine. We'll tally that up for the next time he dies in the film, which is coming up. We will have the total number for you next time, but the bump still stays.
Bulleted.
And I think to sum up my thoughts on the passenger, Antonioni knows how to end a film. My goodness.
Yeah, oh, I love the ending. The beginning and ending of this movie may be one of my favorite beginnings and endings to any movie.
Both great. Blow Up might be the best ending film has ever had. Yeah, but, you know, few do an ending as well as Antonioni, but none do it as consistently. Like all of his films. Just from 1960 to 1968, he made 5 of the greatest films ever made. Like, it's an insane output that the man had. He slowed down a lot after that, but it just kind of wild what he was able to do and what he sort of shifted how women were viewed in cinema and what a female protagonist could be. And like, he did a lot to help that gender resume a better place in film. And that has inspired a lot of actresses and female filmmakers along the way. Like, he is really a woman's director too. He just has done so much to change cinema. It's very impressive.
That's kind of how I feel about Brian De Palma. From 1978 to 1984, he changed cinema.
Yeah.
For me. Yeah. He's like, Joe, I'm going to make some of your favorite movies of all time. with great female protagonists.
Yeah, De Palma was part of the film school generation too, so it makes sense. All right, Joe, you've got some young rock to recap for us.
My name is Kid Rock.
Oh, do I... Dwantaclaus.
What is this, episode 6? Was this episode 6 of the thing?
I can double check for you if you want.
It mostly doesn't matter. We're still in season 3. We've taken a pause from the main storyline of season 3 to do this dumb Christmas thing.
It was bad. I don't know why you watch this show.
I do it out of love for the podcast, Joe. It's my journalistic duty.
Episode 6 was the first episode I've watched since episode 1 of the whole series. I was not lost because of your lovely recaps I get every time we do this podcast.
But again, none of it's related to what's happened before. You can just kind of jump into this.
Especially the Christmas episode, because it's just like, he's like, hey, these are a couple of Christmas tales.
Yep.
So the first one we get is with Little Rock, right? We call
Kid Rock,
it Little
yeah.
Rock. Oh, Kid Rock.
Kid Rock wants to get a Nintendo.
How could I forget? And he is trying to find a gift for his mom, right?
Yep.
But he doesn't know what to get her. And then
it's tough when you're 8.
Yeah. And he ends up making her a coconut with googly eyes. It's really cute. I like that. It was very cute. But it's already so foggy. I watched this 2 days ago, but he ends up giving her like a coconut with googly eyes like every year for Christmas. And that's like their little thing they do for each other. And then you see like there's a pan where you see all of the coconuts with googly eyes on them next to the tree.
Yeah, it's a little good self-promotion there. You're like, yep, I still love my mama.
Yeah, of course. And that's like the first like bit of the
Well, you forget
episode.
About this sort of weird gift of the magi thing where he makes the coconut, stains her mother's favorite slippers.
Oh yeah, the slippers. God, how can I forget the slippers?
And then he's like working so hard to get her new slippers, but he can't. So he gives her the coconut and somehow slippers are in his tree.
Yeah,
there's not even like a hint that like the grandmother or the father did it. It just is like they're there and we're like, okay, well, we've got to do 2 other storylines, so we're moving on. And I go, wait, what?
Yeah.
Solve that thing.
He just opens up the gift. Don't know, is it even addressed to him? Because he just opens it up. He's like, hey, mom, I found your slippers.
Yeah, just a legitimate deus ex machina.
It's stupid.
Yeah, go on.
There's a third one I'm forgetting because I'm only remembering...
Yeah, there's High School Rock and Wrestling Rock both have a story. High School Rock's story is barely a story.
Okay, so maybe that's why I don't remember
it so
well.
Yeah, High School Rock's one is his mother is like a housekeeper lady for some rich lady, and she's like, oh, look, here's a gift of an ice cream maker.
This is the one, yeah, and then they open it up because they're like, well, we'll just make her an ice cream because they have no idea what to get a woman who has everything. And they open it up and they find like a red wine stain on it, and they're like... She just regifted this.
Yeah,
and then
the Rock's like, and then I learned a lesson about not being an asshole when you're rich. And I go, okay,
yeah.
Great. Well-timed, the Rock.
Okay, and then so the grown-up one.
The wrestler one I thought you'd like. It has all the wrestlers.
They're all really bad impressions of other wrestlers.
Joe, who's this guy that likes Christmas?
Oh, that's Mick Foley. He's actually obsessed with Christmas. Like, he does do this for real. He goes to...
So
like,
he said, I'm doing charity stuff. You can't do it with The Rock because you're a heel. And then I see him at the charity thing, and he's got, like, a big leather thing over his face. And I go, you're not the heel?
He is a heel. I don't know what he's talking. I mean, I guess for maybe a little, I don't know what year this takes place, but Mick Foley, Mankind, was a heel for the majority of his run. It wasn't until like later on that he was like after he started facing The Rock at like the end of 98 is when he turned face, which is a good guy. And then that's when he was a good guy. Like this makes no, I don't know when this show is actually taking place. It's driving me nuts. But anyways, I want to say I loved the outfit that Stone Cold Steve Austin is wearing, which is, he's wearing a white turtleneck, a long white long sleeve turtleneck, his black leather vest, and a gold chain. And it's just like, I've definitely seen the real Stone Cold in a picture like that. And I'm like, this is so incredible. I love this outfit. Yeah, they go to a charity event, or like they go to a, what is it, an orphanage or something like that?
Yeah, it's something to do with these underrepresented children, underfunded children, not represented, obviously.
Yeah, and so they're handing out gifts, and then The Rock shows up as the Grinch, and he's like, he's got the green face paint on and everything, and he's in a Santa outfit, and he's like, pretend he's gonna steal the toys, and then Mankind and Stone Cold come and beat him up and take the toys back and give them to the kids, and I'm like, oh, that's...
Do you know if this really happened in your travels? Have you ever come across this anecdote?
I've never heard of anything like this, but, I mean, if I can probably read one of those books, and maybe they talk about it there.
Yeah, it's fine. Yeah, so the crux of the episode is The Rock is the most generous man alive, which is why he's the Dwayne Claus. Thank God we have The Rock in our life.
Yeah, and he ends the episode by saying, he's like, so why don't you put milk and cookies and a little shot of tequila and then get rid of the milk and cookies and give Dwayne Claus. I'm like, Jesus Christ.
Dwayne Claus wants to get loaded tonight. And I go, you're on national TV.
Yeah, also, like, stop promoting your fucking tequila.
Ah, well, if we thought The Rock was getting on our nerves, we have to check in with the rest of Hollywood at the moment. I was a rock watcher.
Oh, what a great segue. Yeah.
Joe, you had sent me this last night, but I had actually found this earlier that day. It had come out pretty early yesterday from Variety, and I now just get alerts all the time on this stuff.
Great.
Variety by Tatiana Siegel. Secret meetings, tequila, and Black Adam versus Superman, : how Dwayne Johnson's bid for DC power flamed out. And ooh, baby, does that headline get me? There's a Nietzsche quote that I'll skip because I don't want to bore you. As much as I love Nietzsche, I've given you a lot of existentialism today. We'll just give you the fun stuff now.
It's okay.
All right. Tatiana says, the DC Extended Universe endured the most tumultuous 12 months any studio division in 2022. Yeah, that's probably true.
Like what? What was the other DC movies? Oh, the Pets? The Super Pets didn't make money?
No, the whole studio itself has had a tumultuous year, though not necessarily financially terrible, just like,
oh, okay,
the whole everything's gotten upended since the beginning of 2022.
Can I just add one thing to that?
What?
Hold on, one thing. I want to say that John Cena is part of the Suicide Squad, which is what James Gunn is now the head of DC. It was a James Gunn movie. James Gunn made a Peacemaker show starring John Cena that was for HBO Max. It ruled. So fun, so violent, and I'm just like, why can't things be more like this? And I'm like, I like the direction if James Gunn is really overhauling this whole thing and like taking it a little more like, hey, let's just try to add some fun and not make these movies so boring and serious.
Well, I'm glad you like Peacemaker, Joe. I look forward to HBO canceling it promptly and removing it from its platform to never be seen again.
I know.
Amid the upheaval, the release plan for the upcoming Flash teetered following a series of arrests and meltdowns involving Ezra Miller. Closely guarded Aquaman deal points were laid bare in the Johnny Depp Amber Heard defamation trial. Oh shit, that was this year.
Yeah.
And the $78 million Batgirl movie was permanently shelved in post-production as a write-down. Idiots. All that was an appetizer for the executive shape-up that landed James Gunn and Peter Safran in the DC driver's seat. But perhaps nothing as dramatic as Henry Cavill returning as Superman, only to lose the gig 2 months later. As 2023 kicks off, DC bosses Gunn and Safran continue to sift through the rubble and will soon reveal their three-year interconnected vision for the... Oh, I can't wait for that boring-ass presentation. Good lord. At least they're only doing 3 years out. But it won't include Cavill Superman or Wonder Woman at all. Wonder Woman? You're not going to do Wonder Woman at all? That was like the only thing you did well the first time. How do you not fit her in?
Okay, because the second one was such a shit show with like... for... the for everything for the release because it was released during like the like Omicron thing or whatever, where like the pandemic was still fucking raging. They're like, let's put it in theaters, and then they didn't consider all of the payments to the director. Like they paid the director and the star like bundles and bundles of money because they know they wouldn't be making that much money when it first came out because they had the deal where they would get some of the money from the box
back
office.
End, yeah.
Yeah, thank you. That was a big problem. And then I guess there was having a lot of like script issues with the second one, and like it didn't make it. The movie makes no fucking sense. It's about like a wishing stone.
What?
Yeah, no, it's weird. The first one, like, it was a romp. It had a lot of energy in it. This one, it's just so weird. It barely gives Wonder Woman anything to do. It looks like shit. I don't know why, because it wasn't shot during COVID. But yeah, the whole release was just so bungled. And when they were trying to like do the deal for the third one, because this was going to go pretty much straight to HBO Max after that.
Well, HBO Max isn't like that anymore, so.
Yeah, no. This was at the beginning of 2021, when they just started releasing all their movies, all the WB movies to HBO Max.
Well, maybe I won't have to deal with Gal Gadot for a while now.
I feel like she's kind of going away a little bit.
That's good. I don't remember why she became insufferable to me. She did something that really annoyed me, and then I found out she was in Cleopatra, and I got even more annoyed.
Maybe the end of March, beginning of April of 2020, like when everyone was stuck in their house, she got a bunch of her like rich Hollywood friends to sing this Imagine video. Do you remember that?
It wasn't that, but I'm glad I didn't know about that, because that would have been really annoying.
Yeah,
really.
They're all annoying. Like, hey, it's gonna be okay, don't worry. And they're like all in their rich like houses with all like their like security and everything. Yeah. And everyone's like struggling to get like toilet paper.
Well, anyway, Tatiana goes on and says, but things could have gone in an alternate direction. Behind the scenes, a different group made a play for control of DC. Not long after the Warner Brothers Discovery merger in April, Dwayne Johnson directly pitched CEO David Zaslav, the wild card of Hollywood at the moment, on a multi-year plan for Black Adam and a Cavill-led Superman, in which the two properties would interweave, setting up Superman vs. Black Adam showdown. Black Adam producers Hiram Garcia, who is Johnson's former brother-in-law, we haven't seen him in the show yet, and Bo Flynn also were part of the Brain Trust looking to take DC down a new path. Other sources confirmed the meeting, but downplayed any discussion of Black Adam's future. If Dwayne Johnson is involved in these meetings, Black Adam is a big part of the future. That's me. That's me talking. Tatiana then goes, although the move took place amid a power vacuum created as former DC head Walter Hamada and Warner Brothers film chief Toby Emmerich prepared to exit, it ruffled feathers internally, sources said, because Dwayne went around everybody else. He cut ahead of the line, jumped over all the stupid middle managers, and went to Zaslav himself, and everybody was pissed off about it. Which I get, but also I get why Johnson didn't want to deal with all that crap. Eventually, new Warner Brothers film co-heads Michael DeLuca and Pam Abdi approved a Cavill cameo, despite the fact that Emmerich made the call in 2018 to find another actor. Why didn't they want Cavill back? Did he eat somebody? Or, like, what's the deal?
I think it's just all the Snyderverse stuff. They just probably didn't want to, like, add that to it.
All of your fans want him back.
Yeah.
And your thought is, well, we want to make movies not for our fans. Like, what's the thought there?
He's also getting older. He's going to be an old Superman? Like, you want a young Superman.
We got young Robert De Niro. I'm fine with old Superman.
Okay. You brought it up. I'm going to stop you for one more second. So someone on YouTube went back and fixed all the bad de-aging in Irishman. Yeah. They said that bad is their words. And they did a, what is it called? The deep fake. They deep faked young Robert De Niro onto like old Robert De Niro.
Yeah.
In the movie. It looks a lot better.
It's always going to look better.
But it's just like they used a lame deep fake app like thing,
yeah,
instead of like whatever
advances.
Crazy technology they have.
You know, like it's just it gets exponentially better
what is it,
every year.
Months difference. Deep fake technology has existed for a while.
I know. That's why it keeps improving. Anyway, back to Tatiana. But Black Adam, which bowed October 21st, fizzled with a $391 million worldwide haul. Yes.
Fizzled.
Yes.
it's just crazy that we think of that as like, oh, that's nothing.
Yeah, it had a $195 million budget plus $40 million in reshoots. You spent $40 million to make your movie better, and I still got what I saw in the theater 2 months ago. That was the better version.
What were the reshoots, though? I know all movies need reshoots, but like,
you had 40% additional budget added on to make the movie better. What did it look like beforehand? It must have been horrible.
It's basically one set.
Yeah.
It's just that, like, city, like, the middle of the city, whatever that is.
So this scuttles out any plans from further outings with the lightning bolt-wielding anti-hero, officially ending the Cavill Superman era. Cavill parted ways with his manager, Johnson's ex-wife, Danny Garcia. Holy shit! His manager is Johnson's ex-wife? That's wild!
Yeah, you knew about that!
I had no idea!
No way, you didn't... How did you not know that?
I didn't know that's what she was doing now. That's crazy.
Yes! I thought you knew that for this whole time. They've always been working together.
No wonder The Rock wants to fight Superman. It helps them both out. This is crazy. Holy crap. That's awesome. All right. A source says it was unrelated to the DC drama, and she remains a strategic advisor to the actor. That all is gobbledygook, face-saving, whatever. It means nothing. Don't worry, people.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, the Johnson-Warner's relationship already was wearing thin after Johnson pushed for a producing credit on the animated film DC League of Super Pets, which opened in July, but did little to promote it. The actor, did little to promote it. The actor also insisted on a tequila bar at the New York premiere of Black Adam, featuring his Terramana brand, despite the film being PG-13. His demands increased, and the returns just weren't there, notes another insider. Still, box office analyst Paul Garabedian says Johnson found himself in a catch-22 with Black Adam. You can't have a more modest budget with this level of talent is involved. The one guy. The one level of talent. He notes of Johnson's track record. Budgets are commensurate with the talent involved, something which a lower-budget film like Shazam dubbed a hit because his hits are based more on profitability. When Patrick, me, was commented, my comment was this. Ha! You asshole! You jerk! I'm so happy that you have to deal with this. Anyway, Tatiana goes on to say, Shazam earned $366 worldwide, basically what Black Adam did, but only cost $100 million, and so was a big hit. Black Adam did manage to be in the top 10 box office for 2022, and yet still is not profitable. And she concludes, as for what Gunn and Safran have planned for DC's future, sources describe it as a broad but not blanket reset. At this point, nothing is ruled out, given that Miller has stayed out of trouble since the beginning of his mental... What did he do? Did he eat people?
Who?
Miller, this Ezra Miller guy. What did he do? Mental health treatment.
So... they go by, they use the pronouns they, them.
Oh,
so
sorry.
Know.
Sorry.
No, I'm just letting you know.
I'm saying sorry to the audience. I did not know this. I'm not keeping tabs with Ezra Miller. What did they do?
Ezra Miller's not a very good person. They went to, I guess they were going to like houses in New Hampshire and just like burgling or like just stealing.
Just burgling?
Yeah.
just said, you know what I'm going to do this evening? A little burgling.
And then I guess I allegedly, I was reading articles like randomly, like just as they were coming out last year. They were also allegedly involved with a hostage situation where they took a mother and a son in a vehicle and was just like, you're coming with me. Like they were like, they had a warrants out for their arrest and stuff. Like, and then WB's just like, sweep it under the table. We need this Flash movie to come out. And maybe if we push this Flash movie back till next year, maybe this will all go away. No one wants this movie. It's stupid. Put Batgirl out.
You know, on a similar vein, I had a former friend that liked to go into people he knew's houses when they weren't there and take videos of himself jerking off in their bedrooms.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah. So that's what it reminded me of.
Wow.
Yeah. Anyway, so despite all this information you just said that is publicly known, some executives are amenable to continuing with the actor as the world-saving speedster after The Flash bows on June 16th.
Oh my God, it's actually coming out. It has a date.
June 16th.
Wow.
Aquaman, Shazam, and whatever the hell Blue Beetle is, and James Gunn Peacemaker series for HBO Max, for the time being, all could have a place at the table. Gunn and Safran, who were recommended by DeLuca, have the full backing of the WB top ranks, and in a testament to the notion that no Hollywood relationship has ever truly served, the Batgirl directors are willing to work with DC again. I hope you use these films that are coming out this coming year, because otherwise you're just wasting all of our times. Like, why are we going to care if these movies won't matter in the three coming years, right?
So yeah, Shazam was whatever. Aquaman should somehow get out of this whole situation and be like, hey, I'm just Aquaman. Let me be Aquaman. Aquaman was the only profitable DC movie because it has made over $1 billion. Did you know that?
Of course I didn't know that, Joe.
There is no stupid like tie-in cameos with any of the other DC franchises. It's just a fucking Aquaman movie. It's great. It rules. Julie Andrews plays a giant squid and it rules.
Julie Andrews, who was not Peter Pan in the Broadway musical.
No, that...
It was Mary Martin.
Did we... Yes.
Yeah.
Did you think it was Julie Andrews?
That was the whole joke. Yeah,
it was...
Yeah, and just one last sort of dig at HBO Max. Apparently, David Zaslav has removed like 256 Looney Tunes from HBO Max.
Why? Who knows? There, I guess some rights issues.
Well, and you know, he says to shareholders, listen, all the stuff I'm taking wasn't going to help us anyway. And I go, I don't know if that makes anyone feel good.
Yeah.
Anyway, got any last looks on...
The Passenger?
On The Passenger.
I really enjoyed watching it with the Jack Nicholson commentary. I might just send you that Blu-ray and you can listen to the Jack Nicholson commentary.
Don't send me the Blu-ray. I'm holding out for the Criterion. There'll be Jack's commentary on it.
It should be on there.
Of course, they've already got the recording. They need Jack Nicholson's blessing anyway. Just get that too and then do another one. You know, whatever. Great. I've got all these fucking awesome Antonioni films on my shelf in alphabetical order. There's a glaring hole between Blow Up... And Identification of a Woman, where The Passenger should be. Sorry, Zabriskie Point. I don't, you know, if they do great, I'll buy you, but I don't need you. Glaring Hole, where The Passenger should be, between 1968 and 1982. Put that in there.
What they should really do is a nice box set, like they did for Fellini, like they did for,
I don't want a box set. I already own them all. Just give me the one. I just need the one and I'm done. Give me that. Yeah. And give me, there's something from David Lynch I still need. And like that, I'm done. That's it.
Just the straight story.
No, I need the weird one. The one with Nick Cage. What's that? Wild at Heart. Give me Wild at Heart.
Oh, Wild at Heart. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, the Blu-ray's okay.
What, your last looks, you like the Jack Nicholson commentary? Anything else?
Yeah, vibes. Vibes are good.
Vibes
yeah,
are
the
good.
Mustache on the lamp is fun.
Yeah.
I really like that. When he gets off the phone, he's just like, tapes it up there. Because he's like, I was like, are you just going to peel it off? Or like, is this part of the scene? Are you just like fucking around with your mustache? And then he actually peels it off. I'm like, oh, okay. He's going to get rid of it.
Well, why does Jack Nicholson do this movie? Because he's a giant nerd.
Yeah, because he loves movies.
Yeah, imagine a comic book nerd is approached by, I don't know, George Lucas and says, hey, you want to work on something with me? The nerd would be like, yeah, that'd be great. And so Jack Nicholson got to work on the George Lucas of the film world, so to speak.
That would be if, like, Scorsese came up to me, he's like, hey.
Yeah.
You just want to hang out and, like, watch us edit this movie? I'm like, yes.
Jack Nicholson could have been offered any role in this film, and Jack Nicholson would have taken it. And I don't blame him one bit. Oh, my goodness, what a dream come true this must have been for Jack Nicholson, actual film nerd.
He stated before that this is one of his favorite films he's ever made.
Yes. It's all downhill from here, folks. However many episodes we do afterwards, they just won't be as good films.
There's some good ones coming up.
Yeah, well, listen, good movies are coming up. They know The Passenger. One of the all-time great films. All right, well, I'd like to thank our sponsor, Avis, for sponsoring this episode so I could talk ad nauseum about the film Grammar of Michelangelo Antonioni. I'd like to thank Lev Van Rensselaer for having this edit of this bonus-stuffed episode. And I'd like to thank my co-host, Joe Vekeman, for stopping by.
Thank you.
And I am yours, Patrick Scaley. You may find my features, documentaries, short films, video essays, animations, behind-the-scenes footage, and so much more at QuixoticUnited.com and social media, presumably with a similar-sounding name. Thank you all for listening. Joe, say goodnight.
Good night. Hola.
Hola.
¿Cómo estás?
I'm out of Spanish.
Bienvenido. Welcome to my world.
Zaldora the Explorer over there.
Welcome to my world. Te quiero con todo mi corazón.
Aww.
I don't know what's happening.
That means I said I love you with all my heart.
All right. I don't know if I needed that.
Well, why not?
Yes, I feel like some of your heart can go to your family, right? Because you love them, presumably.
Yeah. I mean, I can love as many people as I want. Bienvenido.
Oh, right.
I know like four phrases.
Yes.
Spanish for 6 years.
Can I just say that I've been watching old Simpsons episodes again.
Which season?
Just kind of any season? Smattering throughout. Random.
Okay.
And it really does annoy me how Disney Plus has pan and scanned the episodes.
Oh, did you know you can fix it?
No, I didn't know.
Yes, you can definitely fix it. Hold on, I have my.
Send me those instructions. Yeah,
it's very, very easy. So you go into your account, and then you go onto the Simpsons. Hold on, I'm gonna do it right now, so I can walk you through it. Because yeah, no, everyone was complaining about that, and then after like 8 months, Disney finally fixed it.
It just, why did you put more work on yourself, Disney Plus? Nobody was mad that there'd be black bars.
Okay, so you go into The Simpsons.
Yeah.
I know you probably don't have it on your phone, but you go to, and then you go to details. You scroll over to details over there. So see how it says episodes suggested and then details? And under details, it says remastered aspect ratio, and you just turn it off.
Sweet.
Very nice, huh? Now yeah. It's on. Now it's off. Now you can see some of the jokes that were out of frame for you.
I know. I just got mad that they did it in the first place. Who did you think?
Yeah, stupid.
Like, what do you think? We're dumb? Do you think we'd be like, wow, this sucks? Why would we hate black bars on the side? We'd be like, oh, great. Look, the intended aspect ratio. This looks normal and feels great.
No, sleepy. I'm sorry. It's very early for you.
Well, I was sick, so I had to take the. I took some NyQuil last night, too.
Oh.
Yeah, I think I was mostly over it. I just wanted to make sure I slept through the night.
Yes.
So I wouldn't wake up tired for today, and then I woke up tired for today because I've got NyQuil in my system. So it's really a self-fulfilling prophecy.
Yeah. It's okay, though.
It is okay. Oh. Okay, we'll do the
passenger.